Penguin Random House Audio presents Fay Wray and Robert Riskin, A Hollywood Memoir by Victoria Riskin. Read for you by Julia Whelan. God gave us memory so that we might have roses in December. J.M. Barrie. Introduction. For my mother, it had already been a great adventure, a sometimes wild ride. She had been put on a railroad train from Salt Lake City to Los Angeles at age 14, somehow entrusted by her strict Victorian mother to the care of a charming 21-year-old man who had said he could, maybe, get her into movies. There had been no money in their tiny home, no man to provide for them, six hungry mouths, and some days nothing to feed them but bread soup. Later, she said, "Maybe Mama put me on the train so there'd be one less mouth to feed." My mother had dreamt of a better life, and perhaps Los Angeles, where she knew no one and had no family within hundreds of miles, could provide it. The year was 1920. And Los Angeles was a rough, busy, unfinished town. Her young man proved as good as his word. He took her to a respectable rooming house where she stayed for a dollar a night, which he paid, and then found a family who promised to look after her. Walking in Hollywood, she was seen by a producer who offered her a bit part as a clown at $5 a day. After another small part or two, she went alone to the Hal Roach Studios, told them of her acting experience, and asked for a weekly contract. They gave it to her, 6 months at $60 a week that soon was $75, a handsome salary for the time. By 1933, she had grown into a beautiful young woman and was atop the world, literally. The immortal scene played out on the Empire State Building, where she dangled in the giant hand of King Kong, the largest and most terrifying gorilla the world had ever seen. As audiences gasped, airplanes swooped around, firing machine guns at the beast. Before Kong fell to his death 100 stories below, he made sure the woman he loved was safe on a ledge. My mother made more than 100 films, some with the outstanding producers and directors of the era and opposite the greatest leading men, Gary Cooper, Spencer Tracy, William Powell, Victor Jory. She used her earnings to buy her family a home in Hollywood and support them in comfort. But along the way, there were challenges. An overbearing mother and marriage to an Academy Award-winning writer who soon revealed himself to be an alcoholic. Then came an infatuation with Cary Grant after they had starred together on Broadway, a brief romance with Howard Hughes, and a serious one with the playwright Clifford Odets. Real love, a man she could love and who loved her back, had eluded her. In 1930, on the day my father arrived in Hollywood, on the 20th Century Limited from New York, he went to the Columbia Studio on Poverty Row, where second-tier movie companies were situated. He was ordered to report immediately to Harry Cohn's office, where the famed, tyrannical studio boss was conducting an inquisition among Columbia's executives and contract writers about a stage play, Bless You, Sister, he had just bought, to be directed by Columbia's top director, Frank Capra. Cohn turned to the newcomer and demanded to know if he had anything to say. My father had written the play and, with his brother, produced it on Broadway, where it had failed despite positive reviews. He told Cohn he thought it would fail as a film, too, and gave his reasons. Cohn and Capra went ahead anyway, and the film failed. From that shaky and inauspicious start, my father went on to have a celebrated career as a screenwriter, working mostly with Cohn and Capra. The films he wrote are still considered classics that helped define America to itself and the world. Lady for a Day, The Whole Town's Talking, It Happened One Night, Mr. Deeds Goes to Town, Lost Horizon, You Can't Take It With You, Meet John Doe. It Happened One Night was the first film to sweep the five top Academy Awards, Best Picture, Director, Writer, Actor, and Actress, a record matched only twice in the three quarters of a century since, by One Flew Over the Cuckoo's Nest and The Silence of the Lambs. My father's films reflected love for his characters, especially the ordinary people he cared about and the smart, independent women who were equal to, at least equal to, the men they were paired with. His films were admired for their wit and charm and the spirit that even in the middle of a grinding depression, problems could be solved if we only worked together. He was called on by Harry Cohn to give judgments on most pictures Columbia put into production after It Happened One Night. He mediated heated arguments between Cohn and Frank Capra, Columbia's top director. Outside the studio, he was a strong and active supporter of FDR and the New Deal. He helped his fellow screenwriters establish a union, and as the 1930s wore on, he became increasingly concerned about America's isolationism and went to England to help Great Britain in its fight for survival against Hitler. He also had relationships with actresses Glenda Farrell, Carol Lombard, and Loretta Young. Involved and busy as he was, by his early 40s, he was increasingly aware that something fundamental and important was missing in his life. My parents met at a Christmas Eve party in 1940. My mother's first marriage had ended in divorce, and although she was spending most of her time with Clifford Odets in New York, she was briefly in Los Angeles to make a film and see friends. My father crossed the room to talk to her. By the end of the evening, he had invited her to see an acclaimed new movie, The Grapes of Wrath. And that night, or very soon thereafter, he fell hard. Whether because of her intelligence, her wit, or infectious laugh, or the way she listened to him with undivided attention. The morning after their first date, he sent her a dozen red roses, and in the following days, he saw her as often as he could. After she returned to Odette's in New York, he told friends he was heartbroken. It would be the following December, 2 weeks after Pearl Harbor, before they found each other again. And this time, when they connected, my parents both knew they had found the intimacy they had longed for. When my father was slow to propose, she proposed to him, and they married in New York in a small ceremony attended by a few close friends, including Irving Berlin, David O. Selznick, and William Wild Bill Donovan, and set out to make up for all the time they had missed together. 1. Life is all memory, except for the one present moment that goes by you so quickly you hardly catch it going. Tennessee Williams. My first memory is of a snowstorm in Los Angeles. The land of eternal sunshine had never in its known history been blanketed in white the way it was on January 10, 1949. The old Farmer's Almanac gives the date, and never has again. I was 3 years old. My brother Bobby, 5, had already dressed himself and run downstairs to join our 13-year-old sister Susan outside. I fidgeted impatiently while our English nanny, Miss Hayslip, in her starched white uniform, secured the buttons of my blue corduroy trousers suit and put rubber overshoes over my Buster Browns. My father organized a snowball fight that morning on the front lawn of our Bel Air home. Bobby and I pelted each other until a snowball hit me in the face and I burst into tears. My father scooped me up and deftly distracted me into helping him make a snowman. He also recruited Bobby, who was a genius at building things, and let me tuck in stones for the snowman's eyes and a carrot for his nose. This, he emphasized, was the most important job of all. There you go, rascal. You stick that carrot right in the middle of his face. In the photographs of that day, my mother is absent. For years, I imagined she was in the kitchen having the cook prepare the hot chocolate to warm us when we came in, or rearranging the living room rugs and furniture for an evening of square dancing that was all the rage in the late 1940s, or readying a dinner party for the friends who regularly came to our house, Jack Benny, Rosalind Russell, Ronald Coleman, Cary Grant, Jimmy Stewart, Irving Berlin, Harpo Marx, Daryl Zanuck, Edward G. Robinson. I now understand that she was outdoors with us all along, taking the photos with her Leica camera, recording our lives, memorializing our family's landmark moments, as was now her passion. Snow and snowman and, indelibly, my father in his tweed newsboy's cap, woolen scarf and heavy overcoat, tortoiseshell glasses, tanned olive skin.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.